Jesus Christ is risen from the dead and lives and reigns to all eternity. It is most certainly true that he died and rose again for you to make you right with God, to adopt you as children of the Heavenly Father, and to set you free from sin and death. As a called and ordained servant of the Word, I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Almighty and gracious Lord, pour out your Holy Spirit on your faithful people. Keep us steadfast in your grace and truth. Protect us and deliver us in times of temptation. Defend us against all enemies and grant your church your safety and peace. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Please be seated.
redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God put forward. Then what becomes
of our boasting is excluded.
By what kind of law?
By the law of works. No, by the law of faith. For we hold that one is justified by faith apart from works of the law. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand. Gospel reading comes from Luke chapter 12. Hallelujah, fear not, with the flock.
For it is your Father's good pleasure to give you the kingdom. Hallelujah.
The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the great shepherd.
Glory to you, O Lord.
So Jesus said to the Jews who had believed in him,
you abide in my word.
You are truly my disciples. You will know the truth, and the truth will set you free. They answered him, We are offspring of Abraham and have never been enslaved to anyone. How is it that you say you will become free?
Jesus answered them, truly, truly, I say to you,
everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin.
The slave does not remain
in the house forever. The son remains forever. For if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed.
This is the gospel of the Lord.
Thank you.
nature that lead us to do the same things, like turning up the volume on the TV, turning up the thermostat, tuning out the world. Jesus knows that we are creatures of habit, that those habits are for the most part bad, sinful, perilous. That one of those habits is to be accustomed to who we are, comfortable with who we are, and pleased with who we are, so that we no longer come to Him on bended knee, asking for forgiveness, life, and salvation, but thinking instead, I got those things, I can be content. I would say to my heart, rest. The context of our gospel is a little bit like that. Jesus said to the Jews, who have we been in Him? Sometimes the tense is all important. Jews, who had we been in Him? Why had they been in Him? If you read the Gospel of John, after all, John 8 comes after John 6. You may remember John 6 is a chapter in the Bible where Jesus feeds 5,000 people with a few fish and a couple loaves of bread. I could get behind a guy like that. He also can sight the blind. He has healed. He has even confronted people with their sin and their failure, and in a miraculous way showed them that He knew what was happening in their lives. He raised the dead. For all those reasons, follow Jesus. Like I said, you would do that. More power,
more authority. We would place our trust, we would put our faith in that person because they gave us what we needed.
We don't have to go to work
anymore. We've got food enough, things are covered. We don't have to worry about getting sick. We just go to Him.
And He doesn't even have a copay. He will give what I want. That's our habit.
How we are as human beings. I get a good thing, I want it. And perversely, I want more of it. It's a little bit like a drug. I need to have more and more and more.
And that's what it is to have belief. And Jesus then says to these people who have belief, if you abide in my word, to us, we hear those words. We say, well, yes, of course. I know that. Of course it is. These people, there is a contrast.
You have trusted in me because you have seen the signs. And I am telling you, you need to abide not in the signs. You need to abide in my word, in the thing I am saying. And if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples. And you know the truth. And the truth
will set you free. Now there's some buzz that was created because he spoke those words. There's the friction that takes place. Not quite getting this. We are offspring of Abraham.
We are saying to him because they are. They are all physical descendants. And have never been enslaved to anyone. Probably every time I preach this gospel, I say it, and everybody knows it by now. Home, we have never been enslaved.
It seems to be just kind of a joke. Saw it the way they saw it,
you would say the same thing. And after all, we've got you, Jesus, providing for all these things. You don't have to care about the Romans, you don't have to care about anybody. You've got us covered. Stick with you.
And we won't be slaves. And yet you say you will become free. Well, the answer is because you don't abide in my word. Because you don't abide in my word, you sin. For everyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. Even you children of Abraham. Even you Christians, new children of Abraham, commit sin, you are a slave to sin. Now, that's a different thing from what mistakes, errors, and judgments. We often
go down the wrong path, make wrong decisions, wrong choices. It's pretty hard for us to stomach that three-letter word, sin.
If we manage to get it inside our mouth and
chew on it a little bit, we find that it's bitter to the taste. We just spit it out.
Much.
Like the alcoholic who says, I can quit any time I want. Really?
Why haven't you quit? Because I don't want. You're a slave to sin. I can control it. Do that any time I will. Why don't you?
Because I don't want.
That is the slave.
That is the thing to which we are
beholden, the idol.
Nourish the bitterness that we have in our heart directed towards something. And we hide it. Like the ring and Lord of the Rings, we cherish it.
We cling to it. We think we can throw it away.
Yeah.
For the pride of the
pride in our hearts. It says, I am going to be right. The whole world is wrong. And that becomes our ring, the thing we have to hold on to.
Or it could be lust.
Or it could be covetousness.
It could be being jealous of someone.
Sadness. Depression.
Things we kind of think we don't want,
but if we try to get rid of them, we realize, I don't like this. I don't like my life as it is. I kind of like having you be.
Even though my heart really has
moved on to a different idolatry, a different faith.
To us, Jesus
says, said to the Jews who had believed in him,
if you abide
in my word, you are
truly my disciples.
If you have the word, hold on to that word. You have the truth, it will set you free.
You get then what he's talking about. What kind
of freedom is this? This is freedom from sin. This is freedom from that pride, or freedom from that covetousness, or freedom from that despair, or freedom from whatever that sin is that you secretly cherish and nourish.
In the end, the thing that you cherish and nourish is going to kill you. Do you really want it? The answer is yes.
And yes. And therefore, Lord, have mercy on me. Because you, Lord, know I can't get rid of this thing.
You know, Lord,
how
a sharp tongue. You know yourself. I'm clean to those things. I don't want them, but I want. He has a word for you. is a word that is spoken to you.
This is my body. This is how the New Testament in my blood. And I am giving it to you.
And it is a word that he gives you in the absolution and gives you throughout Holy Spirit. If you abide in his word, the word is forgiveness. Sin in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. He who is, believes and is baptized shall be saved. You eat and you drink this body and blood.
Because through it you get the forgiveness of sins.
Forgiveness of that thing that is in you that you can't get rid of. Release from, that's the common word for forgiveness.
To be released from the thing.
To be let go of it. Are let go of
the sin that is killing you,
the thing to which you are enslaved, then what are you? You are free. You are free. So that someone can take you bodily and throw you into a prison.
And some disease might get a hold of you that racks you and makes you paralytic.
You can go home.
Car wreck today. The hospital with the inability to move.
And you can live in a country where your
freedoms may be taken from you. Any of those things can happen. Guess what?
You are free. You are free from sin. And because you are free, the Son sets you free.
You are free.
It may not look like it.
It certainly didn't look like freedom on that dark day in history when Jesus was led bound before the people and before Pilate, and then freed just enough to be able to carry his cross to Calvary. It did not look like freedom when he was nailed to the tree.
People said, if you're so good, come on down.
Show us that you are free, Jesus.
And Jesus did not do that.
He made himself a slave of God.
He became sin, who knew no sin. And in him, our attachment
to our pet sins and deep sins,
and all are evil. Faithful to death on the cross.
He did what he came to do,
which was to be the sacrifice
offered up for you, so that you do not need to pay for the sins that you commit,
the desires that you
hold deep in your heart, are contrary to the word of God, the idolatry that you have, and he paid it all.
Forsaken by God and man, commended his life to God.
It was finished.
Your sin is finished. Your death is finished. Your future, which was a horrible one,
is finished.
To prove it all,
he rose from the dead.
And in that resurrection, God says to this is his word. It is over. This is what you have.
If you have forgiveness of sins, which you have by Jesus' death, you also have life. Look, he is risen from the dead, and salvation. The future is assured.
That thing that you
have that you fight every day, the thing
you struggle with and wish
to overcome even while you love it.
To come.
It will be gone forever. You, like Jesus, will be raised,
and you will have
life in all its fullness.
That is the truth. Breathe.
God grant that you abide in Jesus' word.
Because if not, you remain
a slave to your sin.
And the slave does not remain in the house forever.
The Son does.
And if the Son, Jesus,
raised from the dead and lives forever, and he sets you free, has not, you will be free.
Indeed. Here's to freedom. And the peace of God, which passes all understanding, will keep our hearts and minds in Christ Jesus.
He is the rock, he is the rock.
gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth, to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory and honor and worship, with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
The Lord Jesus Christ, on the night when he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance."
In the same way also he took a
cup after supper. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do
as often as you drink." The peace of the Lord be with you always. because